Well, thank you. We're very excited to have Dallas Denery here. Dallas is an associate professor of history at Bowdoin College in Maine, specializes in medieval and early modern intellectual and religious history. His book from 2005, Seeing and Being Seen in the Late Medieval World, Optics, Theology, and Religious Life, has been very well received, was just a couple of years ago reissued in paperback, which, you know, for an academic is sort of like getting a movie deal, I guess. And currently he has many publications on medieval and early modern history, and he's currently working on finishing a book on the history of lying. And so we're kind of getting a précis of the book, I think, here today to a certain degree. The working title of the book is Liars, Deception, Dishonesty, and the Origins of Modernity. He is a graduate, has a PhD in history from the University of California, Berkeley, in history, but he also has a bachelor's degree in philosophy from Berkeley, as well as a master's in philosophy from the Dominican School of Philosophy and Theology. So he's a very well-qualified historian, and that's all, I imagine, why you're here, but some of you probably don't know, but maybe there are some secret fans here that Dallas, in his younger days, was actually a punk rock star, member of a band called Sweet Baby, having, as he described, this is punk rock love songs with employing the word baby, right? Long before Justin Bieber ever got around to it. Those songs, by the way, you can still find them on iTunes. So if you want to search for Sweet Baby, you can get a sense of that. But he's, I think you'll agree with me, an engaging lecturer and been talking about some very interesting ideas, does very interesting work, and we're very happy to have him here. So please join me in welcoming Professor Denery.
And now I will sing my lecture. For someone from, I'm a native Californian, and I now live way out in the boondocks of Maine. So to come here where there's good Mexican food is a real pleasure. So appreciate what you have, because I don't have it. And thank you to the Kennedy Center and to Stan Benfell. It's a real pleasure to be here. Is it ever okay to lie? There are really only two answers to this question, and they are opposed. Either it's acceptable to lie or it is not. Of course, most people who think it's acceptable to lie don't think it's acceptable to lie anytime or to lie for any old reason. Rather, they think it's acceptable to tell lies at certain times and for certain purposes. The reasoning here is usually consequential. That is, it's okay to lie if the end justifies such dubious means. So, for example, the kind of example philosophers love is if unjust persecutors, as they are wont to do, come pounding on your door and they say, for example, where's Bill? We need to kill him. And you, in fact, know where Bill is. He's in your closet, say. Do you lie to save his life? Or do you not lie and perhaps let him die? If you answer yes, then you're contending that in this case, the end, saving an innocent life, justifies the mean, telling a lie. Those who prohibit lies, that is those who think you should never tell lies, are often consequentialist as well. If some lies are socially acceptable, they argue, then how will I ever be sure that the person I am speaking with right here, right now, is telling the truth? After all, they might well think, even if I don't, that this is a fine time to lie. Allowing some untruth effectively puts all human interaction at risk. If the proponents of lying usually impose some curb on human cunning, those who prohibit lies generally try to expand the range of non-mendacious behavior in order to soften the keen edge of their moral clarity. They say things like, well, you can choose not to say anything at all, or you can offer true if intentionally misleading responses. We can change the subject. Concealing the truth, after all, is not the same thing as lying. For medieval and early modern Europeans, these two responses to our question, is it ever okay to lie, can be traced, broadly speaking, to the Bible and Roman rhetorical ideas on the one hand, and to the religious writings of the early 5th century Catholic bishop, Augustine, on the other. The Bible might seem a strange place to find support for dishonesty, but it does seem to be a book full of worthwhile liars. Jacob lies to his father Isaac when he tells the old man that he is Esau. The Hebrew midwives lie to Pharaoh. It's even possible that God lies. Consider the first book of Kings when Micah warns Ahab that his prophets are false. It says, "So you see, the Lord has put a lying spirit in the mouth of all your prophets. The Lord has decreed disaster for you." And of course, there's the tradition of the devil's mousetrap, the idea that Christ deceives the devil by hiding himself in human flesh in order to trick Satan into crucifying a manifestly guiltless Jesus. Right here, the idea is that Christ hides behind the flesh of Jesus so that Satan doesn't know that, in fact, Jesus is the Son of God. And they would raise this question in all sorts of interesting ways. My favorite is a question Thomas Aquinas, Augustine, a number of people will ask. They'll say, why did Mary need to get married? She didn't need a husband to have a child. So why did she need to get married? And the argument goes like this. Well, it's good for young men to have fathers, right? But also, Joseph was her beard to deceive Satan. Satan would look at Mary, see her wonderful child, but then see that she was married to Joseph and think, huh, maybe he isn't the Son of God. And so the whole life of Christ in the Bible, for some people, comes across as an extended narrative ruse in order to trick Satan. At a more theoretical level, Roman orators like Cicero and Quintilian passed on the idea that all human speech and action ought to be governed by the rules of oratory. Just as the orator matches his speech and mannerisms to his audience, so we must always match our behavior and words to the demands of the moment. Given the proper set of circumstances, a virtuous person can sometimes lie in order to achieve some great good or prevent some great harm. By contrast, Augustine argued that every lie, whether told to harm or to help, was to be avoided. Every lie is a sin. No hoped-for benefit can justify a person in choosing to sin. There are, Augustine feared, mighty paradoxes in thinking otherwise. It's tantamount to believing that what is evil is actually good, because for all intents and purposes, the liar believes it's good to lie, that it's good to sin. In the case of our friend pursued by unjust persecutors, Augustine holds up the example of the Bishop Firmus, who in similar straits announced to Roman persecutors, "I know where he is, and I'm not going to tell you." Such bravery or foolishness met with predictable results. The Romans tortured him. He still said nothing. And being Romans, they tortured him again. And being the Bishop Firmus, he still said nothing. Evidently, this display of moral integrity so impressed the pagan emperor, he decided to let Firmus go and called off the hunt for the innocent would-be victim. If Firmus can do this, Augustine argues, so can you. Hard advice to be sure, but painfully consistent. Clearly, what we have here is an ethical problem, and to be honest, it's an interesting one. Interesting, no doubt, because it is of such universal concern. Scripture famously tells us that every man is a liar, and experience clearly bears this bit of biblical insight out. So we have an ethical problem that is really central to our lives, touches on situations we confront every day. For medieval and early modern Europeans, the question of lies was more than just an ethical problem. It was a problem with roots that dug deep into the ground of ontology, metaphysics, and theology. The first two chapters of Genesis describe a God who speaks the world into existence through words of creation, prohibition, and promise. He says things like, "Let there be light," and there's light. As it turns out, language not only constitutes the very structure of creation, it also plays a central role in unraveling it. Genesis 3 recounts the story of the serpent, who with two sentences, with two lies, as most theologians had it, undid the work that God had labored at for 6 days. Suddenly the question, is it okay to lie, is much more than an ethical question. And debates about the permissibility of lies necessarily become debates about the nature of the world, the nature of the divine, about how we're supposed to understand ourselves, live with others, and live with God. In offering different answers to the question, is it ever okay to lie, the rhetorical and the Augustinian traditions present two radically different responses to the human predicament. What I'd like to do for the rest of this talk is to show why paying attention to these two approaches to lying, the rhetorical tradition that says sometimes you can lie, and the Augustinian tradition that says you can never lie, is important. How they can help us think a little bit differently about the development of European history. As you can imagine, there are quite a number of good books on the history of lies, lying, and sins of the tongue in medieval and early modern Europe. None of them ever, however, pay sufficient attention to the rhetorical tradition. And for that reason, most all of them end up telling a very strange, if very popular, story about European history. The gist of the story is something like this. It's quite straightforward. A scholastic Middle Ages gives way to a humanistic and rhetorical Renaissance. When the story is told from the perspective of the history of lying, it goes like this. Augustine bequeathed his prohibition against lying to his medieval heirs, who accepted it without question, or at least without many questions, and then scholastic theologians, that is the intellectuals associated with the medieval university, adopt Augustine's prohibition and pass it on to everybody else. The 12th century theologian Peter Lombard begins this process when he gives Augustine's prohibition pride of place in a book called The Sentences, a work that would go on to become the most influential textbook in European history. From there, it becomes canonical, repeated ad nauseum in countless works on theology, ethics, and again in the sort of pastoral literature that preachers and priests use to instruct the laity. Just one example. The 13th century Dominican preacher William Peraldus wrote a phenomenally popular work known as The Treatise on Vices, much more popular than his other main book, The Treatise on Virtues. Predictably, I suppose. Towards the end of that book, in a section devoted to what he called the sins of the tongue, that's gossip and backbiting and, you know, slander, he included a lengthy diatribe against lying. And this is how he this is what he writes. Lies are diabolical. It was the devil himself who first spoke the first lie when he assured Eve that she would not die if she ate the apple. And we, in turn, become sons of the devil when we follow his fatal example. This Augustinian Middle Ages finally gives way to a rhetorically oriented Renaissance in which lies, deception, and dissimulation become acceptable. The evidence for this claim is everywhere, and it is obvious. Castiglione writes his European bestseller, The Book of the Courtier, in which he teaches aspiring members of the court how to win friends and influence people, how to impress, deceive, and lie. Machiavelli causes a sensation when he advises princes to lie when need be. And Giovanni della Casa writes a treatise that soon finds itself translated into almost every European language that instructs the courtier to lie when necessary and how to appear deferential to one's lords without, quote, appearing willing to lick the spittle from beneath their shoes. What is the chain of events, the chain of reasoning that leads to this supposed Renaissance reappraisal of the moral virtue of lying? In a series of lectures from the 1570s on Aristotle's rhetoric, the Oxford scholar John Reynolds offers a typical case in point, one rooted in a skeptical attitude towards the world. We must reject Aristotelian science, he argues, because Aristotle believes scientific demonstration must begin with things we know. The problem with this, according to Reynolds, is we just don't know much of anything at all. What we must turn to instead is the art of rhetoric, the art of assessing the probable, and that will help us make sense of the world. And this is a passage from Reynolds' text. He says, being men with wits enslaved to error, we scarcely know what might be first principles, unmediated terms, or necessary propositions for ourselves, much less for nature. In other words, we simply don't have things that can serve as the foundations of arguments that we can argue from one thing to another and be sure that our conclusions are true. And then he adds a crucial note. He adds the last little passage there. Rhetoric does not create probabilities, but instead perceives them, right? The classic argument against rhetoric is that rhetoricians are these magicians, right? And they can make the bad argument seem strong, they can make the strong argument seem weak, and they can sort of hold people, you know, in their grip to get what they want, right? This is sophistry, right? And what Reynolds is arguing here is rhetoric is not responsible for making things look confusing, for leading people astray. It's the world itself that is confusing. And it's rhetoric, which is a science designed to deal with what is confusing, that is the tool you then need to understand how to live in the world. Reynolds wasn't saying anything new. Pierre Charron, the late 16th century French skeptic, made clear the consequences of our permanent ignorance and our need for rhetoric. Given the great uncertainty and inconstancy of human affairs, he writes, there can be few hard and fast rules to guide our conduct, few principles on which we can always rely. As a result, we often have to reject established laws and custom and common use and instead go off the beaten road and have recourse to difficult stratagems and unusual methods. Human uncertainty requires that we adopt a skeptical attitude that reduces almost every moral and scientific principle to the status of mere probabilities. And the thing about probability is that even the most probable of probable opinions can sometimes be wrong. While it might generally be best not to lie, sometimes, in certain situations, that probable opinion will find itself overruled. Rather than condemn our ability to lie and deceive, the rhetorical tradition accepts it as part and parcel of what it means to live in a dangerous and deceptive world. In the Book of the Courtier, Castiglione would offer similar advice for similar reasons. Before embarking on his depiction of the ideal courtier, Count Ludovico, who's one of the characters in the book, warns that to recognize true perfection in anything is so difficult as to be scarcely possible, and this because the way of opinions vary. When it comes to questions of aesthetics, morals, and ethics, not only do different people prefer different things, but even each change of circumstance requires its own unique response. Later, Federico, another character in the book, advises that in everything he does or say, the perfect courtier should follow certain general rules. Before speaking or acting, the courtier should match his words and deeds to the ever-changing demands of the moment. If he hopes to succeed, he should consider well what he does or says, the place where he does it, in whose presence he is, its timing, why he's doing it, his own age, his profession, the end he is aiming at, and the means that are suitable given all of those conditions. Only through these careful dialectical and prudential calculations will the courtier be able to act in the most pleasing, the most useful, and most beneficial manner. But beneficial for whom? The importance of early modern Europe's rhetorical turn, historians contend, depends on how 16th and 17th century writers answered this question. Machiavelli's response is no doubt the most infamous, but he really is only the very representative tip of the proverbial iceberg. Machiavelli's valorization of a prudential politics is but one example of a decidedly this worldly orientation. Confronted with the vagaries of fortune and a dangerous populace, the prince must act in his own self-interest, and this might require dissimulation, hypocrisy, and lies. Life in the court was no different. And behind the urbane conversations of Castiglione's noble men and women is a constant awareness that the court, and I should add, just in case we're not all familiar, when I use the term court, that's essentially sort of the bureaucratic edifice of the ruler, right? The ruler's court are simply all the people who hang out around the ruler trying to get ahead or serve the state or put somebody else down, right? That's what we mean by the court. And a courtier, of course, is just the name of the people who inhabit and work and operate in the court. The prince might have to lie. Life in the court was no different, and for Castiglione's noble men and women, there's a constant awareness of the dangers of the court. It's full of intrigue, deception, self-serving sycophants who always seek their own success at another's expense. And this atmosphere, prudence, is a tool of self-protection and self-interest, demarcating ever more clearly the courtier from his surroundings, his inner thoughts and intentions from his outward performance. Dissimulating one's thoughts, parrying dangerous and intrusive questions with ambiguous or witty responses is the stock and trade of the successful courtier. Gaspari Palafacino fears that Federico reduces the courtier to a liar. Federico does little to dispel these concerns, adding, even if it's deception, it's not to be censored. So here we have a sequence of events, right, I'll tie this up for a minute, that allegedly transforms early modern Europe. Uncertainty, right? Epistemological, religious, scientific, even uncertainty arising from political and economic transformations, all of these things lead to broad and a generally held skepticism in which truth, often long-held truths, are suddenly up for grabs and out of reach. This is a common historical narrative. Thrust into a world in which deception and illusion is everywhere, our own ability to deceive becomes accepted as an aspect of our lives naturally fitted to our dangerous surroundings. The situation so much the worse in Europe's courts, where the ruling elite of the courts of Europe's ruling elite, as political hangers-on find their positions ever more unstable and at risk as power coalesces around absolutist rulers. Confronted with uncertainty at every corner, surrounded by enemies, competitors, an ethics of deception arises, an ethics that heightens the distinction between our inner and outer, our inner selves and our outer appearance, between what we think, what we do, what we say, and that gradually allows self-interest to dominate our actions, right? The idea here is that the courtier has one thing in his mind and another thing on his lips, right? He appears happy to see you, and inside he's hoping there's a knife in your back, right? So there is a facade that becomes well-established and well-known in Renaissance life. This is a classic story of secularization told from the perspective of history of lying, in which spiritual concerns give way to temporal concerns. So what's wrong with this story? This is where the flatterers, the wheedlers, the gossip-mongers come in, not to mention the time-servers, gift-givers, actors, mimics, perverts, procurers, and sycophants. They're all liars. The list comes from a 12th century writer, a man named John of Salisbury, a good friend of the much more famous Thomas Becket. John knew a thing or two about the royal courts. He worked in them, he was exiled from them, and he returned to them. He wrote voluminously and just about to anyone you can imagine. He served as both a royal and a papal emissary before ending his days as the head of his own court, the Bishopric of Chartres. He wrote a well-known overview of the liberal arts called the Monologicon, and an even more well-known diatribe about life in the court called the Polycraticus. His depiction of life in the court is dire as anything any Renaissance writer had to say about it. To hear John tell it, the court is full of deceptions, illusions, and temptations. There's money, good food, fine wine, easy women, but worst of all are the flatterers, filling you with false praise, urging you on from one depravity to the next. And this is from the beginning of his wonderful section on the flatterers that goes on for, you wouldn't believe how many pages. The flatterer is the enemy of all virtue and forms, as it were, a cataract over the eye of him whom he engages in conversation. He speaks to confuse you. He speaks to make you betray yourself. Most men of this type always speak to give pleasure, never to tell the truth. The words in their mouths are wicked guile, which even when their friends are in error, bellows, bravo, bravo, to their undoing. When medieval writers describe the court, they describe it as the place where the consequences of life after Eden are made most abundantly clear. It's a place that constantly stages reenactments of the fall, with ourselves taking the starring role. Here's what John writes at the very beginning of the first chapter of the first book of the Polycraticus. Oops. It's a dark screen, don't worry. The most dangerous situation that men of eminence have to face lies in the fact that the enticements of fawning fortune blind their eyes to truth. The world heaps upon them its wealth, and its pleasures, and thereby kindles and fosters their craving for self-indulgence. The soul, deceived by allurements of many kinds, proving false to its own inner light by a sort of self-betrayal, goes astray as the result of its desires amid the deceptions of the outer world. The temptations, seductions, and illusions of the court assault the man of eminence, filling him with lies so that he gradually forgets who and what he is, what he should and shouldn't do. John draws on Platonic ideas in this passage. He describes the courtier's relation to the court like the soul's relationship to the body. Just as we must keep the soul free from the entangling pleasures of the body, so must the courtier keep himself free from the lure and temptations of the court. To fail at this is to become lost and alienated from ourselves. But how are we supposed to accomplish that? Just like Renaissance humanists would, John recommends skepticism. And he aligns himself with those academic skeptics who did not precipitate an opinion concerning those questions which are doubtful to a wise man. As it turns out, there are a tremendous number of things that are doubtful to wise men. We cannot be certain about providence, the substance, quantity, power, efficacy, and the origin of the soul, nor about fate and free will, nor do we possess any certainty about most moral and ethical matters, about the use, beginning, and end of all the virtues and vice, whether everyone who possesses one virtue possesses all of them, or whether all sins are equal and to be punished equally. Nor do we have any knowledge about duties and the various kinds of situations which arise in reference to agreements and quasi-agreements, to misdemeanors and quasi-misdemeanors, and to other matters. John's skepticism effectively undercuts most every absolute moral and scientific standard, rendering even our most trusted opinions and long-standing truisms as no better than mere probabilities. In the absence of such standards, for John, for most writers in the rhetorical tradition, context becomes massively important. What we should believe, doubt, and think, what we should do or refrain from doing, what we should say and how we should act, everything depends upon the circumstances in which we find ourselves. John admits the importance of the truths of faith. He's a firm believer, a devoted Catholic. But he recognizes the demands that life in this temporal world impose upon us. He distinguishes between knowledge of faith and the knowledge we acquire from experience. Both have their uses. Let the rule of faith be deferred, he says at one point. We're not going to worry about religious prescriptions right now, he says, as it will be discussed at its own time and place. Learning then involves knowledge of the self, which cannot be attained if it fails to measure its own strength or is ignorant of the strength of others. Notice that John emphasizes the strength of others in this passage. When we decide how to act, we must know the people with whom we are dealing. John often describes the world as a stage inhabited by people who have taken on roles and disguises. Things are not what they appear to be. Just as often, he describes the world as a battleground. And if negotiating one's way through the world of the court is akin to combat, then the rules of combat apply. And John wholly approves the use of strategemata, that is, cunningly wrought military deceptions in overcoming our enemies. John approves the use of lies when we are dealing with people whose intercourse is not in the heavens. Or as he puts it in another place, the work of infiltration recalls from vices those whom simple reason cannot recall. Or even more simply, he says, sometimes we just need to lie. I'm going to turn to one other example. I'm going to turn to the example of Christine de Pizan, who wrote right around the 1400s. Christine de Pizan actually has a wonderfully important place in European history. She is probably Europe's very first professional writer. And a woman to boot, which would have been doubly hard at the time. And she knew the courts inside and out. Her father had been hired into the court of Charles V to be both his doctor and astrologer. She married another man who worked in the court, so she essentially grew up in the court of Charles V. When her husband died, leaving her with three children at the age of 21, she said, "What's the best way to make money?" And of course, the answer is, "I'll become a writer." It succeeded. She worked. She wrote. She became very famous. The members of the courts of Europe bought her works. They read them, they followed them. And this is a wonderful illustration. This is from a manuscript at the British Museum, the famous Harley manuscript. It's actually a manuscript that Christine herself put together. She directed its composition, she directed the making of the illustrations, and I put it up in part because it's beautiful, and in part because I just love reading Christine de Pizan. But also, it shows her in her position at court as additional evidence that she knows what she's talking about. What we have here is Christine in blue kneeling, holding the presentation copy of this book itself, to Queen Isabeau herself. Writing towards the very end of the Middle Ages, at the beginning of the 15th century, Christine de Pizan would advise noble women to follow precisely the same course of action for precisely the same reasons as John did. In The Treasure of the City of Ladies, a book I recommend to all of you, by the way, in a nice, affordable Penguin edition, a handbook for princesses and noble women, Christine distinguishes between contemplative and the active life. While the contemplative life might be more pleasing to God, the active life is more useful and no less religiously justified. More importantly, Christine, who borrows both from Cicero and from John of Salisbury, recognizes that actions must be fitted to circumstances, and the circumstance of life in the court is dire. If the court's a dangerous place for men, it's so much the worse for women. Often living far from their families, politically disenfranchised in their husband's home as part of arranged marriages, surrounded by strangers, hostile and otherwise, Christine makes it clear throughout The Treasure that the noble woman will often have only herself to rely upon. Her husband might begin an affair with another woman, or may side with her enemies in a dispute. Her only defense will be her honor, which she must constantly cultivate. To do this, she must know how to behave at every moment, how to win over her in-laws, the other members of the court, the religious. She must even win the love of the common people so that their voices will cry out in support of her if she is ever wronged. But even if she's successful at all of this, there's danger. And Christine notes this in her book. She writes, "The better and more virtuous a lady is, the greater the war envy very much makes upon her. There's no man or woman so powerful, nor ever was, except God himself, who could avenge himself for every affront. Therefore, the wise princess, and similarly, all those who wish to act prudently, will be aware of this problem and provide themselves with a remedy. Sometimes this remedy will be to violate what seems to be inviolable principles. Though Christine expresses an Augustinian scholastic abhorrence for lies and hypocrisy, sometimes, when circumstances require it, this rule can be ignored. When dealing with her enemies or those who envy her position, sometimes virtue will require the princess to feign friendship for them, to deny knowing she knows things, to lie about herself and others. Thus, she writes, the wise lady will use discreet pretense and prudent caution, which is not thought to be a vice, but is a great virtue when it's done in the cause of goodness and peace without injuring anyone in order to avoid a greater misfortune. I began this talk with a contrast between two responses to the question, is it ever okay to lie? The rhetorical and the Augustinian, and suggested that they represent more than merely two ethical outlooks. Rather, they assume vastly different conceptions of the human predicament, about our relationship to the world, to each other, and even to God. I also suggest that if we pay attention to the rhetorical tradition, the trajectory or development of European history might begin to look a little differently than we are accustomed to having it look. I want to wind this all up by coming back to those two points. With their advocacy of virtuous lies, both John of Salisbury and Christine de Pizan complete an intellectual journey from uncertainty to skepticism to probability to deception that many early modern thinkers would soon be making. The man of eminence, the courtier, the princess, the noble woman, constantly on guard against the plots and schemes of others, cannot help but be aware of the menacing and unknown interior depths of their interlocutors. By the same token, how can they not be aware of their own secrets? The difference between their unspoken intentions and outward appearance. as they assume misleading and false gestures to mask the goals from those around them. Of course, someone might object. Perhaps medieval writers wrote these things, but did anyone ever listen to them? Did anyone actually behave this way? Consider what Herbert of Bosham had to say about Thomas Becket, John's friend in the Dedicatee of the Polycraticus. And I put this one up because the logic in it gets a little tangled. This is supposed to be in praise of this guy. And as you would begin any eulogy for somebody, he says, "O performance of duty unique in its virtues and works of discretion, this charioteer of virtues, skilled at concealing from view the motivations of his deeds, in short, an ornament of all wisdom and knowledge by which often he dissembled no less wisely than knowingly what was being done, so that one thought that what was happening was not really happening, and that what was not happening was in fact happening." I often say this about my best friends. "And by the instruction of these virtues, things were done again and again, contrary to charity, but out of charity, against the law, but for the law, contrary to piety, but for the sake of piety." The Renaissance did not invent the practice of deception, dissimulation, nonchalance, concealment, sprezzatura, or impression management. The Renaissance did not invent the notion of the virtuous lie, nor did it somehow teach people for the first time the difference between their inner and outer selves. These are all things that popular historical narratives to the contrary extend back to the Middle Ages, if not before. To be honest, I find it hard to believe that people didn't know all about this the moment they recognized the difference between thinking and speaking. Homer's Ulysses certainly knew it. Disguised in rags and unrecognized, he lies to his poor wife Penelope, reducing her to tears in the process as he tells her of her husband's many sufferings. And it's Ulysses that Torquato Acedo, the 17th century author of a book called On Honest Dissimulation, cites when he explains his modern technique of concealment. This may be beginning to sound like a very tired kind of argument, in which the medievalist claims that everything new is old again, that there's little in the Renaissance that can't already be found in the Middle Ages. And perhaps there is some truth to this. Certainly, I think it's important to recognize that the medieval advocacy of deceit and deception, along with the promotion of a certain rhetorically inflected skepticism and the acceptance that this world, with all its challenges, sets the context within which people must live their lives. I think it's also important to recognize that all sorts of traits allegedly defined the early modern individual, concern with self-presentation, emphasis on the distinction between inner and outer self, a need to maintain independence from others, a certain aloofness from the world around us, all of these things are clearly in evidence in medieval writing. And if they are in evidence in the Middle Ages, and this is really the key point, right? If they are in evidence in the Middle Ages, then they cannot be used as unambiguous indicators of a modernizing and secularizing Renaissance Europe. In fact, it suggests certain continuities, similarities, a common outlook, a common conception of our place in the world that extends at least from the 12th century through the 16th century. A contrast with the Augustinian tradition on lies will highlight what I think we need to pay attention to in this history, and it'll bring me to the end of this talk. Augustine's scholastic heirs, those theologians of the late 12th century through the 16th century, the age of scholasticism ranges anywhere from about 1150 all the way to 1600, depending on who you talk to. These writers who loom so large in traditional histories of lying in the individual did recognize that some lies are more sinful than others. Still, no lie was without sin, no matter what the reason, no matter what the circumstance. The 13th century Dominican theologian Albert the Great may have come closer than any other scholastic thinker to suggesting that context can justify lies. In the end, he doesn't, and his reasons are important. Albert wrote a very influential medieval commentary on Aristotle's Ethics. In the course of it, he asks whether a person can lie to prevent great harm from befalling the state. He suggests that we can approach this question in two ways, right? We can approach it from the perspective of theology, considered in terms of religion and theology, can we do this? or we can consider it from the perspective of civic virtue. And he says, if we consider it from the perspective just of civic virtue, where you can justify means and ends, you can weigh out 10 dead or 1,000 dead, right? Perhaps you could justify a lie. While Albert's distinction between evaluative frameworks, the theological and the civic, may seem to bear some sort of resemblance to John when he decides to put the teachings of faith aside and just consider what it means to live life now, or when Christine gives privilege to her account of the act of life, in the end, it's not a distinction that Albert takes seriously. And for him, theology is all that matters. Put differently, at least when it comes to lies and deception, scholastic thinkers believe that the practical intellect operates not with probabilities, but with universally binding, context-free first principles when evaluating the outer limits of virtuous human action. Our very human nature with its proper ends demands this, they argue. The rhetorical tradition understands human nature, ends and aspirations within demands this world makes on us. Scholastic thinkers look beyond this world. Or to return to the English rhetorician John Reynolds, the scholastic wants their proofs to be understood with reference to nature itself, not to us. So where does this all get us? First, it gets me a drink of water. First, I think it really should compel medieval and early modern historians to be much more careful when thinking about their respective periods. Scholasticism, the writings and ideas associated with the medieval university, cannot be used to characterize all of medieval intellectual and ethical life. Medievalists are guilty of this when they let the pronouncements of some theologian, typically Thomas Aquinas, to stand in for the entire Middle Ages. Early modern historians are guilty of it when they contrast the 15th and 16th centuries with the opinions of some scholastic theologian, typically Thomas Aquinas, and allow that opinion to stand in for the entire Middle Ages. These sorts of false comparisons really do a disservice to our attempts to make sense of pre-modern European history. Without doubt, scholasticism was a sudden, powerful eruption from within European society. It was important, it was influential, but it was hardly totalizing, nor was it monolithic. Standard treatments of scholastic ideas about lying entirely ignore these strains, the strains theologians felt as they tried to reconcile Augustine's prohibition against lies with biblical examples of divine deception. Elements of the devil's mousetrap are everywhere in scholastic writings. They can be found in Bonaventure, in Aquinas, in Robert Holcott, in Jean Gerson, even in Martin Luther. And while all of these writers argue that God, by definition, cannot lie, they resort to the very rhetorical ideas they shun in other contexts to make their humanly incomprehensible case. Second, perhaps scholarly emphasis on the discovery of the individual, a thesis at the very heart of Renaissance studies, thanks to Jacob Burckhardt, and crucial to many accounts of European secularization and modernization, is a red herring, a thesis built entirely out of false comparisons. Historians often look at Renaissance conceptions of the individual and argue that it shows evidence of something new, right? A conception of human beings as self-interested and self-willed, sovereigns over themselves, more worldly. In other words, they see it as evidence of a society more like ours, and hence the origin of our modern world. But if we look for continuity instead of differences, if we don't rush to contrast Renaissance court writers with scholastic theologians, we find something different. We find a continuing tradition of court literature that shares a fundamentally similar conception of our place in the world, of the individual, and it need not be modernizing or a secularizing conception of the individual. Renaissance rhetorical writers only appear modern and secularizing when compared with the Augustinian scholastic tradition, as if that one tradition represented all of medieval culture and taken as representative of a lost medieval age of faith. As we have seen, though, a rhetorical tradition can go hand in hand with the idea that adapting to this world is not a betrayal of religious values. John and Christine are entirely clear about this. So were early modern writers. Giovanni della Casa, whose popular etiquette handbook was translated into English in the 1500s under the title The Refined Courtier. justifies the use of lies in explicitly religious language as conforming to charity. In other words, it might not be good to lie, but it's better to be charitable. And if you need to lie to be charitable, a religious virtue, then you can lie. Here's what he writes. Charity is better than truth, and every man is willing to be cozened to his own advantage. Meaning, just lie to people and make them think what you're telling them is good. They'll buy it. The rhetorical tradition offers a decidedly worldly conception of human existence, but they add you can be worldly and religious. Do things ever change? It seems that I'm offering stasis to transformation. I'd suggest something different. Instead of attending to the individual and changes in the way people think about the individual, perhaps we need to pay attention to the interaction between scholastic and rhetorical ideals. We need to pay attention to what, for this talk, is the future, to the 17th century, to writers like Descartes, who reimagine the relationship between these two traditions, who find a way to be rhetorical and scientific, and I might add, religious. Thank you.
Okay, well, thanks, Dallas. We know that some people may need to leave for class. If you need to do that, please slip out. I think Dallas would be willing to entertain some questions for a few minutes, so those who would like to stay and don't have to run off are welcome to. And then we will open it up for some questions. And Sarah here is... Because this is being recorded, if you have a question, please wait for Sarah to bring the microphone to you so you can ask the question into the microphone and we can get it on tape or whatever digital format we're using. Okay, questions, please go ahead. I'll just...
You're very kind.
Usually we're supposed to introduce ourselves. So I'm Heather Wood, and I'm studying history teaching.
Okay.
But so my question is, when you were first opening up the introduction of lying in early modern Europe, I was thinking of The Three Musketeers. That book just seemed like a prime example of all the characters. They're always lying to each other.
Right.
And even the king and the cardinal are always lying to each other, and it's just this huge game. But we were looking at it a lot of, sorry, I'm trying to use kind of the language you'd used. We had the rhetorics, science, and then we had religious aspects. How do you think, like, novels or popular reading would fit into those categories?
Right. Well, first of all, you can find... If you read medieval books, the greatest romance in medieval literature is Tristan, Gottfried von Strasberg's Tristan. And Tristan, of course, is idealized as the greatest courtier. And the reason he's the best courtier is because he hides and lies so well. So there's this great moment in Tristan where the court musician starts to play his harp. And King Mark looks at Tristan and he says, Tristan, do you know how to play the harp? And Tristan says, well, I've had some lessons. I'm really not that good. And what I assume is sort of the 12th century version of rock on, the harp player says, harp up, and gives Tristan the harp, and he plays. And of course, he's better than anyone has ever heard before. And King Mark looks at Tristan, and the text reads something to this effect. I wonder what other secrets he's keeping from me. Like, this is all he can hope for. So what I would, the long way is, I think these ideals are in the courts all along. The challenge with using novels is what you want to find is, did people find this morally acceptable or not? Because that's where you really pick up the change. And so I like to use sort of handbooks and people who claim to be writing opinions as opposed to fiction, because then you don't worry whether they have a portrait of some courtier lying, you find out whether they think those lies are good or not. It's a big problem in Tristan, for instance, whether they're making fun of Tristan or if it's sincere. Does that help?
Thank you. I'm Glenn Cooper, professor of history. I have a question that about religious dissimulation mm-hmm. as part of this strand, perhaps, or part of this history. And something that you said struck me as odd with regard to Augustine. Now, I'm aware of the Augustinian tradition that it's never okay to lie, but that seems to fly directly in the face of his stance towards the Donatists. This early heresy, just to recount for the audience, in early Christianity, there seems to have been negative attitude towards Christians who would dissimulate their Christianity in the face of persecution. In other words, you were supposed to suffer if they identified you. And yet, bishops and members of the church often did dissimulate to save their lives. I mean, who wouldn't, right? But the Donatists then said, okay, you guys that dissimulated, you're no longer valid. Your priesthood is no longer valid. We cannot receive communion from you. And so then they then rejected these people, okay? Well, Augustine said that's wrong. He said that's a heresy. You've got to accept them, okay? Now, what I'm interested in particular is the strand in religious dissimulation, say, when the heresies start beginning in the Middle Ages, and of course they're going to dissimulate their position, right. And the church responds with the Inquisition to root these people out. Does religious dissimulation play any role in your book? I mean, you've focused on the rhetorical.
Right. I focus on rhetorical because my sense, most histories that get written on this focus on, you know, so Perez-Aguirre has a wonderful book on ways of lying, which is essentially about religious dissimulation. And everybody has focused on that, and they focus on Augustine. And they treat the Augustinian tradition as sort of this thing you can't avoid that everybody accepted and fought, and no one objected to. And so the part of this was to recover this whole other tradition that is there all along. Jerome got into a famous debate with Augustine mm-hmm. On this very issue. Jerome saying you could lie sometimes. So that's why I did it in this particular case. Now, the other thing about Augustine, even though he knows all lies are sins, some are not so bad as others. So in the case of the Donatists, for example, you're lying against faith, which is pretty bad, but if you sincerely repent, perhaps you can find forgiveness again, right? So in the case of the Hebrew midwives, in that case they sinned, but their sin was a helpful sin, and anyway, they're Jewish, they didn't know about penance yet. He has all sorts of ways to get out of it, But this is how they try to argue it.
Interesting, thanks. Actually, my question is related to that, the idea of religious dissimulation. And I'm thinking, I'm familiar with this just in sort of the very practical context of the Mediterranean of the 16th and 17th century. Where you have lots of Christians, especially, but also Muslims, but more Christians who are converting to Islam, for the most part voluntarily, almost entirely, and then at a certain point they sort of come back to the faith of their childhood, return home often to Christian lands, and then go before the Inquisition. And the Inquisition has this really, at least in southern France and in Venice and in Italy, has this really pragmatic approach to this whole question of religious dissimulation, and that is the distinction that they make between your external actions and the interior sort of intent mm-hmm. of your heart, and it was there was almost like a formula where these people who had converted and often lived as Muslims for decades and raised their children as Muslims. It would come back and they would acknowledge, yes, I ate meat on Friday, and yes, I did all of these things, but in my heart I remained a Christian.
Right.
And the there was almost like this institutional acceptance of that,
right.
That the Inquisition would sort of make and say, well, that was a bad thing, do a few Hail Marys or something. It was a really minimal sort of an act that they had to make to re-enter into
right.
the community. And I don't know if that's different from what Glenn was talking about in terms of the medieval Inquisition, if there's less of sort of a forgiving a nature approach to this, or if this is something, you know.
Well, I guess it's, I mean, it's a very interesting case. I think there's two things. There's something about the absolute statements and positions people are making, and then how they apply them. One of the things, I've done a bunch of work on the Augustinian tradition and on theologians in the 13th and 14th century. And one thing you do notice, even when they fully accept Augustine, I mean, that's a hard way to live. And they are constantly trying to stretch the limits of what honest speech could be, right? And you see this in all sorts of places. And the most absurd case it comes to is in the notion of mental reservation, right? Where someone will say to you, for instance, "Did you kill Bill?" And you respond by saying, "I didn't kill Bill." And then to yourself, you say, "Yesterday," right? The idea being, of course, that inside you were being honest, because in fact, you didn't kill Bill yesterday. You know, you did it 5 minutes ago or something. But the idea there is similar, right? You, in your heart, you say one thing. And now, Augustine, I don't think, would have had any tolerance for that sort of behavior, but those things get stretched, especially, I can't speak to the Muslim case, but especially in the Reformation, under torture and things like this, this becomes, and what I find interesting in it, it's, you have one tradition that says, well, you could do these things, and then you have another tradition that says you can't, and then they have to try to find ways to make it possible within those assumptions, and that's when you see sort of the limits of that way of thinking, it sort of becomes clear.
I work in 15th, 16th, 17th century Netherlandish stuff. It becomes clear that in society generally, I would say that lies were more forgiven males than they were females. That it goes back to the whole humor tradition, that being of the wet and cold humors, women were more prone to deceit and to lying and all of those things, that it was immediately categorized as a lie if it came from a female. But less so from a male. I mean, I've done a lot of reading about Christine de Pizan, but not particularly the way that you talked about her. I'm curious if that is a tradition through the Middle Ages, that it was more allowed to men to stretch the truth than it was to women.
Yeah, you know, this is the last section I'm working on the book, so I'm only beginning to think about this as a chapter on women, because women are natural liars. Right. I mean, this is what they thought, right? sure, Dallas, sure. But this is both from the Bible because of Eve, right, and from the Galenic tradition, like you mentioned, right, about bodily humors and things like this. And what's interesting in the case of Christine is she's very explicit about this. You know, she'll say, she actually instructs women in her book. She'll say, you really have to make sure people like you. And what that means is you actually have to plan out every moment of your day. And that means that you have to go to church. And when you go to church, you want to make sure you go to church at the time when the most people are there. And you want to make sure, if possible, that some of the people from the village are out front. And you want to make sure that, you know, and she maps it all out. It's as calculated as anything you could imagine. And what's interesting is this is her response to a world full of liars, in which there's a misogynistic tradition in which women are thought to be natural liars, and here she is counseling them to lie, right? As if feeding the opposing viewpoint, or the misogynistic viewpoint. I know she does it. I know that there is another woman, I'm gonna forget her name now, who read her books and wrote her own versions of these things for her daughters to read, in which she counsels the exact same behavior. And I have a friend, Tracy Adams, who, after I started working on this, looked into some of this more, and she thinks that there is a tradition of this sort of female response to life in the court, where they try to make this acceptable. But in general, you're absolutely right. If a woman said something, there's reason to doubt it. I can't speak to that. I'm not sure in actual censuring what happens. And how often the church actually censured people for lying is hard to say. They weren't censuring Thomas Becket, well, until the very end, maybe. or many of these other people. I just can't speak to that so much.
Ah.
I know of nothing like that for men.
Hi, I'm Stephen Fabiano. I'm an international relations major, so I'm a bit out of the water here. But I was wondering, maybe a bit speculative, but based on your comment that the court writings did not change substantially between the medieval and the Renaissance period, how would you expect those writings to be relevant in navigating modern bureaucracy?
Well, no, that's it's that. Have you ever read Irvin Goffman, The Presentation of Self in Everyday Life? It's sort of a classic American, it's like one of the great American sociological texts of the, I think it was in the 50s he wrote it, maybe the 60s. And he talks about, you know, how people behave with each other, what they should do. And the remarkable thing about it is this is the kind of practical advice that is always useful. Right? So you could go back and read Christine de Pizan and read what it says. She's writing in a very religious culture, so a lot of her advice is, you know, you might want to put on a slightly hypocritical display of your religious zeal, but that might not be so relevant now. But I think the kinds of advice, the kind of awareness, the need to pay attention to circumstances, I think all of that is, it's about as unchanging, I think, as anything has been that's sort of come out of the Western intellectual tradition.
Okay, I guess we do have a group that's scheduled to use this room, so that'll have to be the last official question. I'm sure Dallas would be happy to answer things more informally here just outside the room. Thank you.